Friends, let us pause and hold silence as we center ourselves for worship. This is the house of the Lord. Hear the word of God calls us. Let us stand in body or in spirit and open God's life-giving word for this community. If you're able, please stand. Good evening. Welcome to worship on this Good Friday. Very warm welcome to guests joining us in person and online. You are most welcome in this place. A reminder, there's no benediction until Easter Sunday, and at the end of the service we leave in silence. The sun did not rise today. The day stayed grey, the world seen in black and white. Society turned against him. Left standing in that lonely place, in the greyness as day gives way, lies the brokenness and the sorrows of humanity. Let us worship God, hymn 380. There is a green hill far away. Thank you. Let us pray. God of love, we are ashamed to come before you today, remembering what our ancestors put Jesus through that dreadful Friday. The saving grace for us is love. The love that Jesus proved was greater than anything humanity could throw at him. In such love we remember today, a love to which there is no limit, to which God will not go to be with us, a love we carry with us and we give thanks for every single day, a love we share with others that all might come to know such love that is for everyone, no matter who they are, no matter what they do, no matter what. We are sorry for those times we chose to turn away from that love. Forgive us, Lord. We are sorry for those times when love is the opposite of our words and actions. Forgive us, Lord. Come tonight to acknowledge your love, to stand at the foot of the cross in solidarity with Jesus, who gave so much for us, and who you want to give so much in return. Accept our worship this evening and draw near to us as we unite our voices with the church across the world. In the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Choir will now sing the anthem.
Thank you.
pastor and the choir for our introit and anthem. Our scripture lesson is simply three words, one verse from the Gospel of St. John, chapter 19, verse 30. Let's listen for God's word. It is finished. Amen. A task completed. A battle won. A love confounded, all said and done. A promise fulfilled. New hope for the world. God's plan. The gift of God's own Son. It is finished. 391. This is your coronation. Tonight I want to share with you thoughts from a chapter of a book I read just this last week by the Reverend Dr. Sam Wells, A Cross in the Heart of God, Reflections on the Cross. That third word in our gospel reading, finished. Here is a naked man. He's been beaten to a pulp. He's bleeding hand and foot. His arms are spread eagled, so he can't even fight off flies or wipe away sweat or blood. He's practically alone. He's more or less isolated. He is certainly totally humiliated. It's almost impossible to look at a picture of such agony and misery. And at the climax of this ghastly scene, John's Gospel tells us that this man says a single word: finished. Think for a moment on the host of meanings that that word has. Finished. The dissertation's finally edited and handed in. Finished. The marathon is run and I'm totally done. Finished. The relationship is over. They told me they no longer love me. Finished. The art of work is complete and ready for display. Finished. I've served my sentence. I can come out of prison. Finished. Surely Jesus' climactic words from the cross must be ironic. This isn't the way the story is supposed to end. Remember that heavenly host of angels above Bethlehem singing about peace on earth. Surely this wasn't the way they imagined it would end. And remember 5 days ago, those crowds on Palm Sunday waving branches and shouting their loud hosannas. Surely they weren't thinking of apocalypse 5 days later. A lot of other words might capture it: ruined, betrayed, wasted, lost, destroyed, devastated, ravaged, spoiled, wrecked, but not finished. What might this word, finished, mean? Let's look closer and see if we can discover what was finished that Friday afternoon. One thing that's finished is the blonde Jesus with the constant smile, the loose-fitting toga, and the baby lamb constantly wrapped around his neck like some primal life jacket. There's nothing sentimental about the cross. There's no guitar-playing, yogurt-eating, country road singing, long-haired lover in the face of the cross on Good Friday. Another thing that's finished is the conquering Jesus with that righteous fist. The Jesus whom the crusader thought he was upholding as he smashed the head of the infidel. The Jesus whom the Inquisition thought it was promoting through torture and cruelty. The Jesus that obliterates other religions from the face of the earth. The Jesus whose name is invoked to justify one race of people or gender or sexuality, giving them self-sanction to oppress or marginalize others. On Good Friday, Jesus doesn't conquer. He's humiliated. He's defeated. He's dragged through the streets like a slave or a dog. The Jesus that gives credibility to human power grabs is gone. Finished. And that's by no means all. Jesus, it makes for good citizenship, stable social relationships, is finished too. Jesus died a criminal's death, a murderer and a thief either side of him. Jesus that doesn't want to rock political boats or disturb the neighbor. That Jesus dies in the face of the cross. That Jesus is finished. And what about the Jesus of the mathematical equation? The Jesus that says, take one drop of total human depravity, add a pinch of divine grace, mix with one broken law, blend with one innocent death, and then subtract one angry devil. That Jesus, he seems subject to some extraneous logic, invisible to the eyes of the disciples, but obvious to the well-formed cosmic legal historian. That Jesus disintegrates in the face of the cross. Because if Jesus were simply a component in a mathematical equation, the all legal formula that got us off the devil's hook, then why would the Gospels tell us so much about the disciples who deserted him, the women who followed him, the mother who loved him, the sinners he forgave, the sick he healed, the person he accompanied, the blind he led? By the time we get to the cross, the Gospels have shown us enough about Jesus. Not just to show us how much he loves us, but to make us love him. The cross is not forensic symmetry, but wondrous love. The Jesus of the divine bargain is finished. And then there's the Jesus that watches idly while earthquakes destroy countries, while a pandemic affects a generation, while civil war becomes just a way of life across the world, when a loved one develops cancer or some terminal illness, when droughts affect continents, when a friend like Judas can no longer take the darkness and ends their own life. Nero watched from afar and fiddled while Rome burned. But Jesus isn't looking idly through some heavenly telescope. Jesus is suffering an agony as bad as any known to human experience. Jesus isn't tucked up in the sky, peering down from a safe distance. Jesus is in the middle of a human train crash. The glass and wheels and rails and twisted metal contorting his body and piercing his soul. If you ever look up to the sky and shout, "Oh God, why?" you're looking in the wrong place. You need to be looking into the face, into the eyes of the crucified Jesus. That distant, remote control God has nothing to do with Christianity. In the face of the cross, that Jesus is finished. And here's a painful one. The Jesus that belongs to the church, the Jesus that gives the affirming thumbs up to everything Christians set out to do, the Jesus that makes congregational circles of holiness and a cradle of wholesomeness, that Jesus withers in the face of the cross. It's not clear when the church began. Maybe when Jesus gave the keys of the kingdom to Peter. Jesus says to Peter, "Feed my sheep." When Jesus breathes on the disciples and says, "I send you." Maybe when the Holy Spirit descends at Pentecost. But a good bet for the beginning of the church is right at the foot of the cross, when Jesus hands his mother over to the care of his beloved disciple. You can see Mary representing Israel, the beloved disciple representing the church. And Jesus' instruction, Jesus' instructions betraying the inextricably destiny of the two. Not a glamorous scene, is it? Not some mega church focused on growth. Lends a whole new irony to Jesus' words, "Where two or three gather, I am with them." In the face of the cross, there is no place for self-congratulatory church that's holier than God. There's only room for a church that looks like Jesus. Any other church, like any other Jesus, finished. The most important thing of all is the cross confronts us with the fragility of Jesus. Not Superman who leaps down and says he's only joking. He suffers until the end. And we wonder how this awful spectacle can be possible and necessary for salvation. We're supposed to wonder that. We wonder whether this tiny, broken, wasted body can possibly be the body of God. We're supposed to wonder that. We wonder why God doesn't utterly reject us after we've shown the very worst that humanity can do. We're supposed to wonder that. All of those wonderings should be part of our faith, our imagination, our daily prayer, and our compassionate hearts. When we see the pain, when we feel the grief, when we look upon the loneliness, when we touch the wounds, when we hear the cries, in the face of the cross, we know that God will go to any lengths for us. Any other notion of God, any other speculation about God's wishes, any other ideas about what lies at the heart of God is gone. Finished. Jesus' final word. Finished. His life is finished. His ministry is finished. The scriptures are finished. The reconciliation of garden creation is finished. And a host of misconceptions are dispatched at the same time. Jesus isn't a cozy companion. He's not a triumphalist conqueror. He's not a law-abiding do-gooder. He's not a legal formula. He's not a heartless onlooker. He's not a pretext for Christian self-satisfaction. All those idolatries are finished. They're snuffed out like a line of candles. Finished, 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 finished. Everything is finished. Everything is desolate. Everything is laid waste. Everything is lost, except the heart of God laid bare. And if you're not seduced by a comforting Savior, if you're not mesmerized by a merciless hero, if you're not domesticated by a model citizen, if you're not assessed by a mathematical equation, if you're not alienated by a distant deity, if we haven't fled from the cross like most of the church for most of its history, tonight we might just get close enough to glimpse that sacred heart laid bare. And we might just get to read what's written on that heart, pierced and finished from love of us. And we might just believe the words that we see written there. I swear to you, our time has just begun. Glory be to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forevermore, world without end. Amen. When I survey the wondrous cross, Let us pray. Lord God, tonight is a reminder of your love for us. No matter who we are, what we have done, nothing can break that bond. In a world where many carry a cross of one description or another, we take our prayers for that world to you, O God. For those whose bodies are failing and death is not far away, in the face of the cross we pray. For those weighed down by grief, whether recent or revisited, in the face of the cross we pray. For those who fear the future, uncertain of what will be when it will unfold, in the face of the cross we pray. For those who face prejudice in any of its many forms, in the face of the cross we pray. For those who carry the guilt of causing pain and damage, in the face of the cross we pray. For those who see no end to physical or mental health problems, in the face of the cross we pray. For our part in the destruction of your creation, in the face of the cross we pray. We thank you, Lord, that we can bring all of our prayers, spoken and unspoken, as we sit at the foot of the cross. May this time serve as a reminder of your continued and relentless love for us. Whoever we are, wherever we are, we offer all these prayers. In the name of Jesus, so be it. Amen. A dark day draws to a close, a barren place filled with shadows and death, loneliness and uncertainty. We leave with thoughts of what might have been. What's next for us? Where do we go from here? We sing the praise of him who died.